So I live in New Haven, Connecticut, and therefore, since state courts are the central facet of adjudication in the United States, wanted to start with a 1784 courthouse in New London, Connecticut, that is still operating today as the center of a lively and vibrant set of problem-solving institutions around the country. These courts are interacting with the text in their constitutions. So I've given you from 1818 a little bit of text from the Constitution of the State of Connecticut and a little bit from the state of Alabama in 1819, which of course echoes the Magna Carta, all courts shall be open and every person for injury due to him and person property remedied by due course of law. You can find these words in many other state constitutions of that era and now. Of course, the choice of this is also to remind you that as you look at those words, every person, whether it's north or south, those every people aren't the every people who are we today. Because in Connecticut, blacks, women or men could not, and women, white women could not vote and participate. So the idea of the every person as full juridical person is a limited subset of the world that we come to think of as the courts that we believe are the institutions we want to have as vibrant institutions. So if this sets the stage for the state system, come here to Texas in 1861 and move a little westward, where you're looking at a building that today might be confused with a courthouse, but its name is actually Custom House. Because in the 1850s and the 1860s, the US federal government owned about 50 buildings around the entire United States, and none of them were courthouses. There were no buildings that said US Court on its front door. There were fewer than 40 federal judges around the United States, and they didn't need a building of their own. They were tucked into facilities like this. And of course, what the US government did was this was a form of tax, and Marine Hospitals health care was a part of the US government repertoire at the time. What happens, of course, is the Civil War, and with the Civil War and the North conquest of the South, a great interest in instantiating a federal presence and transforming power and new norms around the United States. Congress enacts vast new amounts of jurisdiction. The Department of Justice in 1870 is founded, and we move on to the building of a federal court system. And if I move forward now to 1935, I'm in an iconic building by Cass Gilbert, which is the US Supreme Court building. Now, of course, you realize this is the first building of its own that it gets in 1935. It's a fake old building. This is modernism and Art Deco. No, this is a fake Greek temple that is trying to think that it's, that have you all think that it's been there forever. And its front facade it says equal justice under law. The architect picks those words because it fits the facade. They had not appeared. They don't appear in the US Constitution. Only after the court do they come to appear as words in cases and are in hundreds of cases now. At the back, justice, the guardian of liberty, when the cornerstone is laid in 1932, Chief Justice Charles Evan Hughes uses the word liberty dozens of times in his talk and never says the word equality. Why doesn't he say equality? Because their equal justice under law is no more our equal justice under law than their all persons are every person that we think of today. To be really clear about this, look at a 1938 federal district courthouse in Aiken, South Carolina, where the Works Project Administration, the WPA, is funding the building and arts and artists around the United States. So an artist does this mural, influenced, obviously, Mexican muralists are influenced here. And he explains that while he's trying to portray the icon of justice, Ayusticia, he is doing it without the customary sword or scales or book. The only allegory he's going to let himself have is the red, white, and blue of the U.S. flag. What happens when a reporter enters the room? The reporter says she's mulatto, i.e. her skin is dark, and the federal district judge is appalled that she should be behind the bench where he's supposed to sit. He suggests the mural be totally removed. The National Association for the Advancement of Colored People protests. The artist offers to repaint because he doesn't mean to say anything by the skin color. It's a problem with the pigment. And the denouement, if I look back for a minute, as you see their drapes, she was covered in drapes because in 1938, a mulatto could not stand as the representation of justice, no more than law was treating people who were understood to be mulatto as equal under the law. In 1938, this is an image from a courthouse in Idaho, and no one batted an eye in thinking that it was inappropriate at the time. We can't find any objections to the idea that an Indian being hung wasn't something that you wouldn't put into a courthouse. In the late 1990s, a judge from the area said, oh, this is awful, and tried to cover it with drapes. The tribe said, local tribes are reported, and the legislature is saying, actually, let people see and understand the values of our time. Well, of course, this is the 1930s, and by the 1950s with Brown versus Board of Education, and then in the 1970s with the case Reed v. Reed about women's equality, and now more recently with Windsor as the shorthand for equality crossing and transforming understandings of sex, gender, and marriage, the equal justice under law becomes the tagline for the court, and we now think back and think this is the equality that we thought courts were all along all the way. And so now if you go and just glimpse the federal courts over the 20th century, there are fewer than 30,000 cases total in the beginning of the 20th century across the United States. More are criminal than civil. By the end of the century, there are more than 300,000 and many more civil than criminal. If we do judgeships, you can look and see there are about 100 at the beginning of the century, more than 850 life-tenured, independent, as Jonathan Fanton was describing, judges. And then here in St. Louis, Missouri, poignantly for today's circumstances, is the largest federal courthouse with its tall and some might say aesthetically awful kind of looming presence. But in this long tradition of courthouses as icons of government, we are now looking at what we think of as a building that is supposed to be welcoming of the lot of all humanity. And through the publicity with Benthamite ideas about the obligations to be shown, the public open court system is now seen as a thriving, fabulous part of all democratic ordering in the United States and around the world, where the norms of egalitarian, dignified treatment mean that prisoner and prison official, judge and litigant, corporate defendant, employee, employer are all under this obligation of something we call equal justice under law. And it's a democratic sight in that we all watch it and can see the interaction as we watch law being applied to fact and norms being developed, which we agree with or don't, in progressive and less progressive ways. So one narrative is the 20th century is the blooming, the invention of courts, the courts that we think of today as really artifacts of the 20th century and the things we think of as stable as deeply contingent on 20th century politics. But there's an alternative narrative to turn to. This is if you were to glob onto the web page that opens for the US federal courts. You can't read the text very well, but there's a text box that is blown up, which basically says, go away. To avoid the expense and delay of a trial, judges encourage litigants to try to reach an agreement and resolve their disputes. And I won't spend the time now, but the alternative dispute resolution inside court is a deeply privatizing activity in which judges are involved in managing and settling decisions, and there's no publicity that lets you see the interaction between employer or guard and the like. And if you move to this, this is a terrible graphic. It's a great graphic. You can't read it. You shouldn't read it. There's no point in reading it because it's your cell phone agreement. And your cell phone, like my cell phone, means that you can't go to court individually or as part of a group, nor can you function as a group in something called a class act or class arbitration, because you and the telephone company both agree. I think it's very sweet that AT&T agrees that it will not bring a class action against me. I similarly can't bring a class action against AT&T. And instead, I've remitted to something called private arbitration. It's not private in the volitional contractual sense. It's a misnomer to call this a contract because I can't bargain for it. We tried. Nor is it bargainable. And it's a package that I buy. It's a thing. It's the same as my phone, and I get a dispute resolution system, which is publicly mandated. So to call it private arbitration is to only describe that the processes are private. You can't go to the hearings and you can't know about the outcomes. And when I just emailed a lawyer who had 1,000 cases in the American Arbitration Association list, he said, I can't tell you the outcomes because that's what we have to do as part of our agreements in this system. So the story in the federal courts is this is the declining trials in the federal courts of 100 civil cases filed in the federal system. Fewer than 2 start a trial today at all. And so that great, vivid public system we're watching contracting. But if we move across the street to the state courts, I've now shown you federal filings across the United States, civil and criminal, about 360,000 cases, plus 1.5 million bankruptcy. State filings, not counting family life and traffic and juvenile, is 40 million. And if I count everybody, it's 100 million cases are filed annually in the state courts of the United States, across the United States. You could see this as a remarkable tribute of a government service that everybody wants to use, a fantastic invention of the idea that all of us think that there's something really useful there, or we're brought there as defendants, willy-nilly, criminal and civil, along the way. And Susan Silbey will tell us more about the role of courts in popular imagination, as will Jamal Greene talk to us some about the role of the Supreme Court in popular imagination. This is, on the other hand, not only so. Democracy changed adjudication by radically revising it and reinventing it. Democracy challenges adjudication deeply. This is the picture at the back of the volume that you all have. William Cliff is a terrific photographer. And I'm sorry to say, sadly, poignantly, unplanned, we're back in Missouri. This was a historic courthouse, and the crack tells you about its deteriorating condition. It was torn down actually because a lawyer brought a lawsuit that it was not compliant with the Americans with Disability Act, and he couldn't get to the second floor or down to the basement without using the stairs. And instead of renovating it, they built a new, quote, justice center that has 100 beds for people in detention. If we watch the transformation of the American court system through the embodiment of this building, you could see a lot. And the last image before we turn to our other panelists here. So Chief Judge Jonathan Lippman of the New York State Courts knows all too well about cracked rooms and the challenges that he will tell us some about, and the dense populations in them with the detention cells will be Steiker's telling us something more about the demands of the criminal justice system on the court system. And this image, so reflected there is the old St. Louis courthouse. That's where Dred and Harriet Scott, that Jamal Greene writes about, was tried and told that they had no juridical personhood, so they couldn't be free people because they weren't persons who could bring lawsuits. This is also where a woman named Virginia Minor said to the state of Missouri after the Civil War and the 14th Amendment, as a privilege and immunity of the United States as a citizen, I should be able to vote. And the U.S. Supreme Court said, oh, of course you're a citizen, but that doesn't mean you can vote. That's up to Missouri, and they've disenfranchised you. So this is an image that tells you that to think of courts in romantic ways is a mistake. There's nothing necessarily just about courts. Only courts produce justice only if the people who populate them and the people who are engaged with them require that they produce justice. The large international glass building was the head of the Equitable Life Insurance Company, and reflected in the back is the headquarters of the American Arbitration Association. So this image lets you see all of the current contemporary issues facing courts today, and with that we turn it over to the Chief Judge of the State of New York, who's thought more about courts than most of us. Thank you.